Now, here, where we're at in Exodus, or the Orit Zeraat, chapter 29, verse 33, it says, "And they shall eat those things wherewith the atonement was made to consecrate," that means to set apart and sanctify, make holy them, "but a stranger," it said, "shall not eat thereof, because they are kedush." Because a stranger is coming in with strange fire, strange doctrine, strange teaching, strange when it's compared to the teaching of His Imperial Majesty. We don't find the root or the branch in His Imperial Majesty's teaching, you understand, and the true teaching of the Tawahido Beta Christian, then we're to cast it out. It's not for us as Rastafari in spirit and in truth. So the stranger could not eat of that atonement. Why? It says, because they are kedush. Now there's a footnote under atonement. And the Hebrew of atonement is kapar or kafar. More correctly, kafar. You understand? Kafar or kapar, what some would say, as Yom Kippur in that sense. It means to cover. Now, the English word atonement, actually, at one meant. That's what atonement means, at one meant, is not, and we have to point this out, it's not a translation of the Hebrew kapar or kafar, but it's a translator's interpretation. It's what we call an interpolation of the translator. So many have gone on and said, at one meant. That's one way of trying to bring the idea a little closer home. But according to the scripture, the legal sacrifice, the lawful higawi mesuait, the legal sacrifice literally covered the offerer's khatiyat. It covered their sin nature and secured the divine forgiveness, the melukotawi yikirta. You understand? The divine yikirta, the melukotawi yikirta, the divine forgiveness. According to the translators, it made Elohim and the sinner and the Chatiatenya at one. In other words, it reconciled. That's where we get the idea of reconciliation. We are now reconciled. We're in good standing with our Father. You know, a lot of people delude themselves, say, "I'm basically a good person. God hears and so forth," but they're deceiving themselves. Because not according to His way. This is how, you know, there are deceiving spirits out there that will make you think like, well, I don't have to listen to that because I feel it's this way, I think it's that way. But who are you? Can you really save yourself? But the Old Testament sacrifice did not atone. The Old Testament sacrifice did not at one. It did not reconcile the Chatiatenya, the sinner, and Elohim, and Egziadi Herlotu Subhat. Why? Hebrews 10 and 4 says, "It is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats should take away chatiyat." It's not possible that the blood of bulls and the blood of goats could take away the chatiyat, the sin nature that's in man, according to Hebrews, Ibrawiyan, chapter 10, verse 4. Now, the Beta Israel, or the Israelite, the Israelites' offering, what it implied was a confession. By bringing the offering, he was confessing of the sin nature, the chatiyat, and of its due desert. The due desert of the sin nature was mot, was death, that has crept into the human family. And Elohim, egziavihir malet lotu subhat baruchu, he covered, literally, he passed over. That's what it means. He passed over those things. It's almost like you have a child and the child does something wrong and they know that they're in trouble, but when they tell you about it and they confess what they did, you say, "Oh, you know what, we're not going to even deal with that this time. Just go to your room or whatever like that." And you don't bring it up again to the child or whatever. You basically pass over that. You understand? And this is according to the principles of Romans chapter 3, verse 25. His sin, passed over that sin, because of the anticipation or the tesfa, the hope of Christos's mesuait, of Christ's perfect sacrifice, which did the mecheresha finally put away. This is where sin nachatiyat, that sin nature, is possible for that sin nature through the Christ and His mesuait to put it away. The sin that was done aforetime, or the wrongdoings that were done aforetime in the forbearance of Ha Elohim Baruch Hu, according to Romans chapter 3, verse 25, Hebrews chapter 9, verse 15. And there's a note in the Scofield, in the Oxford edition of the Scofield Study Bible, there's a note in Romans chapter 3, verse 25. Y'all going to have to study this for yourself, and I really hope and pray that some of y'all get inspired too. Because when you start to study it for yourself and the Holy Spirit open up your heart and your mind to see it, you recognize, you give more praises to the King of Kings and His Christ, because it becomes, it explains those things that we heard about, but for whatever reason, they wasn't, we only got half of the story. But now we get the full truth. You understand? And we can walk in that overcoming. You understand? And we can be those overcomers that Johannes Raio, Raio Le Johannes speaks of, the book of the vision of Yah's grace, otherwise known as the revelation of St. John. Now, the word atonement, this word atonement, or Kippur, or Kippar, or Kifar, or Kippar, or Kapar in the Hebrew, and Suryet, and Astes Rio, it does not occur, you understand, they say, in the New Testament. Now, Romans 5 and 11, meaning, the meaning is reconciliation. One is reconciled. That's a big subject matter in the world as of lately, right? They talk about all this reconciliation on people's jobs. You can't sue the job, but you could reconcile and get mediation and all these things. That's like stealing bits and pieces from God and using it in the worldly way. But now when we put it back into its proper context, it all makes sense. So the meaning is reconciliation, and this is how it's been rendered in the revised version of the King James Bible. But you also have to see sacrifice. And we're not going to touch on that in this particular teaching right now, but you have to study sacrifice. What does meswa'it? What is the principle of sacrifice? Because a lot of y'all, a lot of us, thought we knew what it means, but we had at best only half the story, and sometimes we only had half of the story, sometimes we only had half of the story. You know, so we only had a little bit and piece, and then we were forced sometimes to make up all the rest of that. So the atonement time is a good time to really recognize how we stand and what we stand in this atonement, you know, for even those past bedel or wrongdoings, you understand, because of the sin nature that's in humanity and that we all share in as human beings. You understand? Now, Genesis chapter 4, verse 4, and there's additional references there in the Oxford Scofield Study Bible, the Oxford edition. Also, there's a note, and we're going to return to this note on atonement in Leviticus, Leviticus chapter 16. But it was very important for us to get to the root word of the from the Hebraic, you understand, the Hebraic sense, to understand, well, what does atonement really mean, kapar, or kafar? You understand, kapar, it means covering. You understand, and what is the different sense from Old Testament to New Testament? And we're going to return now to the fulfillment of this in the New Testament, or in the New Covenant, as we go on this particular High Holy Day, this Yom Kippur, Yom Kippur, or Astes Rio in the Ge'ez Ethiopic, and Yesaryet Ken. I give thanks that I'm able to go over this again. You know, because you read certain things, you study it, but there's so many things in the world, and, you know, we get distracted by a lot of other things because there's a battle going on, there's a spiritual warfare going on for our hearts and minds. This is why it's good to read. In fact, it's a blessed thing. Revelation tells us that blesses one who reads. And throughout the scripture, both the reader, the reading is blessed. So the reader, it gets a blessing if they're reading it in spirit and truth. And the hearer, the listener, gets a blessing if they're hearing in spirit and in truth. And then if we seek to study it and show ourselves approved to Elohim Baruch Hu and apply it, we get a blessing. So it is a fullness of blessing. You understand? And but that's all according to how you make your wills. If you make your wills obedient to good influences, then according to your submission, according to your submission to His will, He is more able to bless you and bless I and I. You understand? So that's why it says those who harden their neck. Enough ones are hard in the neck because we are reproving those errors that crept into Rastafari. Nowhere along the line do we blame any personal individual. Say, this one individual, he is all responsible for that. You understand? Except where we have the information to say that they are, such as when we talk about Garvey. You understand? Some people get offended. And I love Garvey. His Imperial Majesty showed great Christness, in other words, concerning Garvey. He forgave him, you understand, in that sense. You understand? But still, that doesn't excuse what Garvey did, or the fact that Garvey is not the one to whom we have to do, but it's the King of Kings. It is Ketamawi Haile Selassie. And when we come to the King of Kings point us to his Christ, and he points us to the Bible, you understand, and to the Holy Spirit, and to the principle of love, you understand, so we can be able to do this work. Because when you get a lot of the negative, you understand, mixed up moods and attitudes, sort of comments that come in, you understand, and provocations and pseudo threats and everything else, you have to recognize that you have to have love to do this work. You understand, love of God in Christ.